We always believe that the academics and the universities always bring solutions to problems of this world. And I believe that if we can sit together and try to find our solution together, I think we can take this world this far. And the other thing is, when all this started, it was in an era of the antibiotics, where this is the era of the pharmaceuticals, where the first antibiotics was discovered, and that was in 1940s, and that was with one aim to heal all most of the disease or the bacteria infections that we had. And from that age, we kind of found another period where there was an obvious resistance of those bacteria against whatever antibiotics that we faced against. And then that was not, let me say, it was intentional, because the bacteria or the microbes, they develop a kind of resistance as a way of defending themselves. If they feel attacked, they bring a kind of system that will protect them, that will make them resistant to whatever you expose them to. So, and then we had an era where we have this development by pharmaceuticals of these different antibiotics, and you can see from the board that from 1940s to 2000, we had this challenging situation where we have the pharmacological part of it, the biochemistry coming in, and also we had two sides. We have the Dark Age, and the other is disenchantment. The Dark Age is just the period where people did not know what to do with all this disease that were coming up. But for me, I would call that age light age. I think I'll explain to you later. Because at that period, people were just going out. If there's any problem, they'll wash their hands and they'll be safe against all other microbes that they'll be exposed to. Until the pharmaceuticals will bring in these antibiotics. But the consequences of these antibiotics, they are obvious. We all see that we have resistance. We have all over, because these antibiotics are used, let me say, misused. You use them in agriculture, you can, the doctors can give to patient, the patient throw them away, and they get involved in the nature. Sometimes I read some article that was published in Switzerland, where they found some antibiotics in the waters. So that means all those kind of things, there's no way that we can avoid that. It's only the way that we are using these antibiotics. So as you can see that they were developing this antibiotic, we have the antibiotic resistance identified, and you have also antibiotic introduced. Once you get a resistance, scientists will always come together. As I said, they always come and brainstorm and then bring some solutions. They bring antibiotics after the other ones from 1943. And 1950, they get the tetracycline, which is, I think I'll tell you about that one, which is, for me, is a very preferred one. And up to 2010, we have 11, let me say that, we have a huge resistance. And up to now, the scientists don't know how to handle this drug resistance. But because of lack of finances, because of lack of commitment, or I would say on the other side, there's a kind of business that is taking place, but we, as academics, we don't look at that side, we look at the way to bring solutions. So, and those ones, and that came to my mind. I say, but when they say it's a dark age, what was happening before the dark age? Do they mean that these two things, the bacteria and antibiotics, were not cohabiting before? They were not existing both in the same world. So how people handle those two things before these pharmaceuticals come together to bring us these antibiotics that they isolated from the nature? So then I said the antibiotic resistance crisis has been attributed to overuse and misuse of these medications, as well as the lack of new drug development, because the pharmaceutical scientists, they are stuck. They don't know what to do, because not like their lack of ideas, but they, whatever they bring about, it does not give a permanent solution. and also due to reduced economic incentives and challenging regulatory requirements. And you find the types of the FDA that bring in some regulations every year, and they're stopping some other new development. So those are the things that I just look at, say, this overuse will always be there because we cannot control people. But how do we remedy this situation? And then, and scientists have been crying, and you can see this in this publication that was published in Gut Microbes, that they say the off-label abuse of antibiotics by bacteria. And the second one is antibiotic resistance, a public health crisis. I just gave three. And the third one is antibiotics in crisis, which was published in Current Biology. So those are the cries of scientists. They want a solution, but in some ways there are some regulations that are stopping them. There are also financial problems and also misuse of those current antibiotics. And then I just travel a little bit back. I said, but how was it handled before by those who once lived before us? So, and I found out that there was a researcher in the University of Emory that published an article in the American Journal of Physical Anthropology saying that he went to discover that in some of the remains of the ancient people, and this kingdom is a Nubian kingdom, which is in the current Sudan, where they got some tetracycline residues in their remains. So that means those people, as I told you, that tetracycline is my preferred one. It means that these people were using antibiotics to cure themselves. But how did they do it? What happened is the way they were preparing their beer. So that means that somehow there were some fermented krill containing the soil bacteria, streptomyces, and that streptomyces can synthesize itself, the tetracyclines. So that means we give the nature the privilege to do itself the work than us to do that, because when you go to the nature, we isolate a compound as a chemist. You isolate from the natural product, from the plant, from bacteria, from whatever. You don't understand that there are some synergetical interactions that makes that particular drug to work effectively. So when you isolate it from the whole crowd of other compounds, you find out that it can work for a time, but because of the bacteria, we develop another kind of resistance. That particular compound cannot resist the system that the bacteria has brought about to resist the attack. So if we leave it in the nature the way it is, there are some synergical actions that can take place, and that can make the oat work. Once the tetracycline does not work, it must be something in that particular plant, in that particular natural product, that we come together to remedy or to fight the resistance that the bacteria has brought about. So I thought we should just go back to the nature and find on how we can remedy that. And for that, I just said we revisit the natural product in antibiotic drugs, because you think that you cannot get antibiotics from the natural product. And I've been involved in some natural product isolation, and I work on some anti-gonorrhea, because where I'm from, I'm originally from the Congo, but I lived in South Africa for 20 years. We normally go to indigenous people, find out from them, what do you use in plants to cure a kind of disease that you are facing? And we went to another culture in South Africa where they use this plant, which they call Asparagus sylvalensis, to cure gonorrhea. But they did not have a proof, because we know this world of us today, if you don't have a proof, no one will believe you. They'll tell you, okay, you are saying it kills this, but where's the proof? And to make the matter worse, the scientists will tell you, where's the scientific proof? So you just get stuck in the middle. So we went to different villages and got a certain plant that we call asparagus, and we investigate the anti-gonorrhea property, activity of that plant. So we prove that just to back up the knowledge of indigenous people. Because if we wait the ideas of the FDA to develop a drug, I don't know if you are aware of that, to develop a drug will take 15 years. In 15 years, how many people will be dead by then? So, but indigenous people have the knowledge. We can just, as a scientist, we can come up with the strategies on how to back up their ideas and publish these articles, and that we give some other people hope that, okay, even if I use this drug, it's been published, it's scientifically proven that it kills, though it's in vitro, but at least you in vitro and in vivo, we just do that because we are doing that in a laboratory, but if we've done it in a laboratory and indigenous people have done it in real life, that means we can prove the point very well. And we continue, and again, another plant that we isolated, it was the Helichrysum cispititium. This particular plant is growing in South Africa, in the southeast of South Africa, where they use it because most of the time they do this traditional circumcision. And in the bush, what they do, they use this plant to cure the infections of those boys that were circumcised in the bush. So, but that means the particular plant has got some antibacterial activities. So how do we prove that? How do we back up the indigenous people or the traditional healers? So we collected the plant and we did some analysis. We find out that this particular extract of that particular plant has got that antibacterial activity. But you ask yourself a question, what if the plant is toxic? How do you prove that? Because some of the plants are toxic and you don't know how to handle them. And the scientists can come up with something to measure or to evaluate the cytotoxicity. Biologists will understand better that, the cytotoxicity of the plant, so that you know this amount of the plant is needed than to do the excess. And the other thing is for the same plant, the asparagus, we did the same thing for the antibacterial activities. And we've been backing up the tradition because in Africa, 80% of the people use plants to cure themselves. Why? First of all, because of the medication are very expensive. It's not everyone that can afford that. So because they can get access to the plant easily, they go around the corner, they get a plant, they go in the bush, they get a plant. Most of the people use plants to cure whatever disease they have. So that's why we say we have really to embark in this business and try to get that done. And as I said, we can try to find out if the plant extract is toxic, and then we end up doing of the same plant, Helichrysum cispititium, we did some cytotoxicity. And you find that some extracts are toxic to the cells and some are not. So at least we can advise indigenous people or traditional healers, you know what, if you're doing this extraction, don't use particular extraction because it will be toxic to your client. You might end up killing your client and then it will be a big problem. So, and recently I got here in Canada in February, but as I was browsing the net and I come across this article that was published this year, yes, in the Chinese Journal of Natural Medicine. You can see here the anti-cancer activities of the S-allyl mecaptocysteine from aged garlic, the same garlic we get from Walmart, from superstore. We can use that, as you can see. If you go to, sometimes when I lecture in my class, I'm not against medication, I'm not against drugs, but most of the time I don't use drugs from the pharmacy. What I do, I just sit down and make kind of concoction. For my flu problem, if I have a running nose, a flu, my running nose that does not last 2 days. What I do, I just take my garlic, I take my lemon, I take my honey, and I take my ginger, mix them together, but I try my best to eliminate the taste of the garlic and the ginger by adding more of the honey. But I know the components are inside there, and there's no overdose. You cannot ever overdose of those things. Those are natural. And then even if they go to the nature, they are not harmful to the nature. So when I take my 2 spoons of that concoction in a day, I'm done. I'm cured. So I'm not against the pharmaceuticals. They are helping us, and academics, I guess scientists and the pharmaceuticals should come together, because we are at the deadline, the deadline where we don't know what to do. Pharmaceuticals don't know what to do. And scientists are like, what next? Because we have to design compounds, but we don't know on how to handle this, because we might have another resistance. And this channel inspired me so much. And I said, oh, that means I'm doing the right thing. I'm going organic. So, as I said, we have to revisit the natural product to discover new antibiotics, and that we can only advise, we can get, as researchers, can get some finances from the universities and also from the government just to push this work. And then that really will help the or bring a solution to this dead situation that we are facing with these antibiotics. Scientists are cracking their heads to find solution, but it seems like it's a permanent problem. Thank you very much. Mm-hmm.